All right, everyone. Welcome to the Tonto's Demise Week 14 recap. This should be a quickie because we only had two matchups this week. First week of the playoffs, only two matchups that counted. Should say that if anyone is concerned, I checked the scores of the consolation bracket. The winners are correct, so I did not adjust the scores there, so it doesn't really matter there. But yeah, those are correct. Just if anyone, I do keep an eye on it, if anyone's actually paying attention to that, you don't have to. But a little bad luck for some people this week. One in particular, we'll get into that. I guess we might as well just dive right into it, huh? Because there's only two matchups to talk about. First one, we had Mighty Midgets going up against Disco. And Disco, you had bad luck this week. Should change your name to the bad luck Bears, because I'm fairly certain this was your lowest performance of the whole season. Let me take a quick look at that for Disco. Oh yes, your previous low score. Well, you actually barely won last week. And I'm sure in week 12, Disco, you scored 232. And then in week 13, you scored 118. So, which way was it going to go this week? And unfortunately for you, your good season, number three seed, comes to an end at the hands of the Mighty Midgets. Let's take a look at the Mighty Midgets and see what he got in order to get past Disco this week. Ben Roethlisberger going for 47. Receivers were Adam Thielen, Adam Humphries, the A-team, and Chris Godwin, putting in two Tampa Bay Buccaneers receivers since Disco was starting Jameis Winston. Looks like those two receivers combined for five catches and 55 yards. So only 10.5 points from those two. Running backs, of course, Kamara and Zeke. 15.5, 34.2 for Zeke. I see he's got a Q next to his name, so I'll have to see. I'm not sure what his injury is. It doesn't say anything here on Yahoo yet. Yeah, I do not see anything about what his injury is, but yeah, he's got a Q there. So thinking about this coming week already here, in case you have to throw in somebody else. Jared Cook, your tight end, 18.5. Here's another Q. I think he has definitely already been ruled out. Austin Eckler. He got you 17.5 points, though. Prater, your kicker, got you about 6.5. And then the Chargers defense, Yahoo says 6. It was probably closer to 12 to 15, something like that. But it was more than enough to get past Disco this week, who actually had a couple zeros in his starting lineup. Let's get right into it. Like I said, those two receivers only scored 10 points. So you're probably not going to have much from the quarterback there either. He only got you 38.5. Your wide receivers, Corey Davis, Tre'Quan Smith, and Calvin Ridley, 4, 0, and 2, respectively. Tevin Coleman, only 5. Your star player this week was Elijah Maguire of the Jets. He got you 17.5 points. Jordan Reed got you 0. He sprained his foot, I believe, and is going to be out probably the rest of the season. Stephon Diggs had to shuffle some stuff there. I think put him in the flex. He got you 12 points. Gostowski got you about 7.5, I think. He had a couple field goals. And then the Titans defense, Yahoo says 13. I believe it was talked about a little bit because that was the Thursday night game. The actual total there was 28. So the only people who showed up for you were Elijah McGuire and the Tennessee Titans defense. Let's take a quick look here because it was just all bad luck again for Disco. No Melvin Gordon. Beckham Jr. was ruled out on Saturday afternoon. So you had to take him out and said you had Diggs in the flex, putting Ridley. I think Ridley was in the flex. He put him up into one of the wide receiver spots. Again, no Melvin Gordon. No Matt Breida either. really not much that you could have done, looks like. Not much you could have done differently that would have changed the outcome of this matchup. It was just those injured star players that hurt you. Just looking at your bench here, your defenses, I really don't think you could have gotten. So you lost by 65. So there really wasn't much that you could do with what you had. And unfortunately, that's the way it goes sometimes. I know Disco's probably pretty upset. His expectations were high coming into the postseason, and rightly so. I think everyone has high expectations, but unfortunately, there's only one of us that's going to end happy. And then after these next 2 weeks here, it said five of us are going to be disappointed. One of us is going to be happy. So I don't really know what else to say. Disco, we clap you out. You had a good season. You made a good run trying to get your first championship, your first Tonto Bowl trophy. But unfortunately, you're going to have to wait till perhaps next year. As for Mighty Midgets, he moves on. He is the number 6 seed, which maybe is that the lucky number? Seems like a lot of number 6 seeds make their way into the playoffs and then go on a run here all the way to the Tonto Bowl title. We'll see what happens here because, of course, the number 6 seed, always, if they move on, they always have to play the number 1. So he will be going on to play from gags to riches here in week 15. All right, then the other matchup, we had the Battle of the Podcasters. Hillbillies on PCP going up against Space Antelope. And this one, not quite as exciting as last week's Hillbillies performance, his matchup last week. Pretty close to what the score that he went up against from Mighty Midgets last week. But unfortunately for Hillbillies on PCP, he had some pretty good scores up and down his lineup there, but he had a couple players that didn't quite come through. While for Space Antelope, he had a couple players go off this week, and that was the biggest difference maker here. I think both of you struggled to select a defense, as you're both carrying 4 of them, I believe. Yes, each of you has 4 defenses. Brian ended up going with the Steelers defense, which I thought was a bad idea. I would have stuck with Dallas. I think surprisingly, the best choice for you would have been the Detroit Lions at Arizona. Would not have guessed that going in, so you can't feel too bad about it. Easy to look back now and say, yeah, this is what you should have done. But anyway, the final score here. Space Antelope cracks 200 with 203.1. while Hillbillies on PCP falls with 158.95. So for Space Antelope, we had Phillip Rivers go for 34.5. Your wide receivers, Julio Hopkins and Julian Edelman. Julio went for 2 touchdowns and 100 yards. He got you 30.5 points. Hopkins, not too much, but he did get a touchdown, 13.5 points. Edelman, 9 catches he got a touchdown too. 23.5 points. Pretty much everyone in your lineup here scored touchdowns. Lamar Miller, 16.5. Sony Michel, only 5.5. Then the big one here was George Kittle. He had a long touchdown, so he actually got you 40 points. He had 210 yards. I believe he was only 5 yards shy. He did everything in the first half of this game. He was only 5 yards shy of the all-time single game yardage total for a tight end. He only needed 5 yards in the entire second half, and he did absolutely nothing, which I just shocks me. I don't know even know how it's possible that he with being healthy, they couldn't get him one easy over the middle or some kind of dump off pass, something for 5 yards to break the record. Like, you could, man. But anyway, a career game probably point total for George Kittle there. Philip Lindsay in the flex, 15 points. Kicker was Lutz. He got you about 9. And then you went with the Buffalo Bills defense. They actually ended up losing the game, but I believe their yardage, they had a couple turnovers. They actually did okay. Yahoo says 9. I want to say the actual total was 16 in there, like mid-teens, maybe somewhere between 15 to 20, somewhere in that ballpark. But it was enough to get you up over 200. It said you got 30, 30, 23, and 37, 40 there. So a couple big scores there carried you to that over the 200 point barrier. And it was more than enough to get past Hillbillies on PCP. He was unable to keep up with you this week. Let's see, he had Cam Newton go for 38.5. His wide receivers, Kenny Galladay, Josh Gordon, and Antonio Brown. Galladay, only 2.5. Josh Gordon, who you've been hyping up, I think Brian has been hyping Josh Gordon for the last 2 years, and he keeps churning out mediocre performances at best. I see, just looking at his game log last week, I mean, he's been a fairly consistent 12 to 15 point scorer, something in that area since he went to the Patriots. Now, that's, I mean, 12 is a score you'll take every week, but you need those weeks where they really blow up and get you 25, 30 points. You need to have those a couple times a year, and you just weren't getting them from him. However, I applaud you for your unflinching faith in Josh Gordon. And then you had Antonio Brown, who only went for 8.5 points. This season has kind of turned into the Juju Schuster show. Although, I mean, just looking here quick at Antonio Brown's game log, I mean, he's been over 20 points most games this year. If he's not over 20, he actually has a lot of 15 and 17 point games if he's not over 20. So, I mean, those are pretty good scores. This was his lowest of the whole season, surprisingly, even though they had to play Jacksonville. You probably would not have predicted that at the beginning of the year. He let you down in your time of your biggest time of need here. What was the difference here? About 45. So yeah, I don't know. So if you would have gotten decent performances from a couple guys, said if you could have gotten 50 or so from your quarterback, which is a reasonable thing to request from him, I guess. No, if you could have gotten 50 to 55, that probably would have made McCaffrey get a little bit more points there. Said Galladay gets you 12 instead of 2. Brown gets you 18 instead of 8. David Johnson kind of ends a disappointing season with a disappointing score here. He had 14 for you. McCaffrey got you 28. Ebron got you 16 and a half. Jalen Samuels got you 16. Butker got you about 7. And then the Steelers defense, Yahoo says 10. Even though they ended up losing the game, they did okay for you. I think it was just a couple more points than that. Maybe 13, maybe 16, something like that. But said even though Detling scored over 200, if you could have gotten some better performance, reasonably, you could have gotten better performances from some of your guys who are some of your better guys. So to get those extra 45 points, it was reasonable to expect maybe an extra 10 from Cam, from Galladay, from AB. So that you, if you would have, perhaps started a different defense that might have changed things up. But I mean, you went with your best players, I think. So Tom Brady got 60. Let's see. Mean, you can't be too upset. You made the. I think you. I'm sure you put. You both the guy. All four guys this week put plenty of thought into their final lineups. I'm sure you felt that this was the best you were going to be able to do, and you just had to, as we all do, you just have to go out there and hope that your guys put up scores that they meet your expectations. And sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. It always hurts because, of course, this is the playoffs, so it's one and it's one and done, or else you keep moving on. And like I said, five of us are going to go home disappointed. Only one person's going to end up happy. And unfortunately for Disc or Brian, he joins Disco at the sad table, licking their wounds. And unfortunately, all hopes of the Tonto Bowl holding up the Tonto Bowl trophy in year 16, Tonto Bowl 16. Those hopes are dashed for you guys. But hey, there's always next year, of course. You made it this far. Not everybody gets to the playoffs. Yeah, there's I know that there's nothing that I can say that can soothe the wound of a playoff loss, especially after a good regular season where your expectations kind of get high and you hope for the best. But as for Space Antelope, he is going to move on since Mighty Midgets, they were the number six seed, so of course they play the number one, which means we have a clash of Space Antelope versus Springfield Isotopes, a rematch of last year's playoffs. We'll see what happens. Will Space Antelope get his revenge, or will he be sent home packing once again by the Springfield Isotopes? All right, so again, we clap out Brian and Disco this week. I know you guys both had, I'm sure, had high expectations for the playoffs. Every matchup is going to be tough, no matter who you face. I talked about it. You guys talked about it in the podcast. Every team that made it into the playoffs this year is a good, strong team and has the chance of knocking anybody else out on any given week. I think I said, I mean, at least from my point of view, I don't know how everybody else kind of looks at it, is that everyone is so pretty even in terms of teams here. The competition is going to be so tough. Not only do you kind of just need your team to meet expectations, you're kind of also just hoping that your opponent has some guys not get hurt, but just underperform. Otherwise, your chances of getting a win, and that's for either one. That's for either person in the matchup. You're kind of hoping that, you know, maybe your team, if they don't perform, you're hoping that they at least perform to expectations, if not exceed expectations, and you're hoping that your opponent maybe underperforms a little bit. As much fun it is for all of us, everybody else who's just a spectator, to see a matchup maybe come down to Monday night and be like a less than 10 point, you know, maybe even less than 5 point difference there. As fun as those are to see, they are miserable to be part of. Let's all be honest, especially now when the stakes are so high. Yeah, so we're down to four teams. We got two more matchups here in week 15, and that will determine who goes on to play in Tonto Bowl 16. Let's take a quick look at the matchups. I see that From Gags to Riches is actually the underdog, according to Yahoo, against Mighty Midgets, who Ben Roethlisberger came back in and played from an injury on Sunday's game. Don't you know, he's got a questionable next to his name here with the little note thing is in red instead of instead of yellow. So that's kind of that means there's news there. So we'll have to wait and see. I'm sure said if Ben Roethlisberger came back in the game and immediately went on a touchdown drive. So I'm sure he's probably going to be rested most of the week and will probably be ready to play in a big matchup against the Patriots. Probably expecting a good performance from him. That's a game that will probably end up being pretty high scoring. But that's said he's got... He had to move Eckler to the bench because of his injury. Plugging Chris Carson in there. I was thinking that he got... Did he get hurt? No. I'm thinking of Chris... I think Clement from the Eagles is the guy that got hurt. Carson, Clement. But yeah, he was your keeper. Said he's an easy plug in there for you. He was said the Seahawks love to run the ball. Should be able to do it pretty successfully against San Francisco there, but you never know. Let's see. I think if Gags had played last week, I think last night was an absolute dud from the Minnesota Vikings. Although maybe it would have been balanced. Maybe the poor performance of Cousins and Dalvin Cook might have been saved by this. You're also having the Seattle Seahawks defense. I don't know if you would have played them against each other, or you would have had the Chiefs defense against the Ravens. I don't know what you would have done there, but if you might have actually gotten bounced from the playoffs this past week, if you would have had to play, I think it's very possible that the Isotopes would have gotten bounced as well if they would have had to play. But they got those bye weeks, so we can speculate till the cows come home. Doesn't matter. Mighty Midgets versus Gags. Taking a look at the lineup a little bit more here. Now I'll let the podcasters do their job and take a deeper dive into the matchup here. But my gut is telling me that just looking at the teams and what the matchups are, I think Mighty Midgets is going to knock off Gags to Riches here. Taking a look, I think Roethlisberger is going to have a huge game stat-wise. Cousins has kind of been slipping lately. Don't know. He's going to be going against the Miami defense. So you've got Cousins. So that will be the biggest factor here in this matchup probably, because I don't think the Midgets are going to start the Chargers defense at Kansas City. So he's probably rolling with the Miami Dolphins against the Vikings here. So that will be the biggest factor to watch in this matchup, the Sunday 1 o'clock game of Dolphins at Vikings be the biggest influence on this matchup. I think Saquon Barkley playing Tennessee. I think Titans defense could maybe shut him down or at least keep him in check. Gags has Devontae Adams and Jim has Thielen. Other than that, like those two guys, I'm not really scared of either one of your, the other four of your wide receivers there. At least, not speaking for myself, scared of them, but like if I was Jim looking at Gags, or if I was Gags looking at Jim, I would feel that that's pretty much a wash. It's going to come down to which one of your stud wide receivers puts up a better game. And then, of course, Barkley and Cook versus Kamara and Zeke. Kamara's not till Monday night, so this matchup actually won't be decided. Probably won't be decided until Monday night to see what Kamara does. The Colts defense, they are at Indianapolis. Zeke there. So Colts defense has been playing pretty well. So I'd be a little bit worried about that if I was Jim. Got Kelsey there. He should be all right. The Seahawks defense, if they were at home, but they're on the road against San Francisco, so that could be, let's see how that goes. I'm hoping that they do pretty well, because I'm pretty much just hoping that they lock down George Kittle, and which I kind of think that they will. He's the obvious guy that you have to stop on that team. I think the Seahawks will be able to do it. but we'll have to wait. We'll see what happens there. Just in terms of overall, the matchups and the overall lineups, I know Gags has been winning all season long. He only lost twice. He had that 10-game winning streak. But I'm gonna pick again. I'm going with Mighty Midgets to knock off, to pull off the upset here and go on to Tonto Bowl 16. And then the other matchup, of course, is going to be Springfield Isotopes versus Space Antelope. Come on, Yahoo, take a quick look here. Space Antelope currently favored by about 15 points, according to Yahoo. This is going to be interesting because a lot of this game, this matchup, is going to be determined by the Thursday night game, which is Chargers at Chiefs. And I seem to think that, was it last year in the set, was didn't the Chargers play at the Chiefs in week 15 last year? Because Brian had Philip Rivers, I want to say, and I had the Chiefs defense. And I think the Chiefs defense actually outscored Philip Rivers that night. I think he threw a couple of interceptions there. He tends to kind of struggle in Kansas City there. But I don't think the Chiefs' defense is as good as they were last year. So we'll have to wait and see what happens. I think you can't trust Russell Wilson, which I think is still your other quarterback, as that team has gone to the running game almost exclusively lately. Still, Philip Rivers is probably the better play. You've gone with him pretty much all season long. I don't know why you would change it now. But other than that, let's see. So it's going to be Mahomes versus Rivers on Thursday night. Got Tyreek Hill, who's nursing an injury, but he played through it on Sunday, hoping that that turns out okay. Who else do we have? The Isotopes kind of struggling in the overall in the wide receiver position there, having lost AJ Green. Doug Baldwin was out this past week. He's nursing an injury again, a different injury. We'll have to wait and see what happens with him. So the Isotopes are most likely going to have to combat Philip Rivers by plugging in Mike Williams and hoping for the best, and hoping that we'll see what happens with Doug Baldwin. Who knows? Might have to plug somebody in here. And then Space Antelope also has Spencer Ware. He is questionable though. He hasn't practiced yet this week. I think he does have a hamstring problem. We'll have to wait and see what happens on Wednesday, maybe into Thursday, before the actual game. I mean, you have Spencer Ware in there right now, probably to counter Patrick Mahomes and any passes that would go to Spencer Ware. But you might end up having to plug one of your other running backs, but you do have a plethora of options here. If Spencer Ware doesn't go, or if you just decide to go against him, so if he's got a hamstring injury, you know what? Don't be scared. Don't be scared of that hamstring industry. Hamstring injury. Go ahead and play him. Just leave him in there. Don't even bother to look on Thursday. I'm sure he'll be just fine. But it also leads to another interesting thing here. The Isotopes have Justin Jackson, the backup to Melvin Gordon and Austin Eckler. Already mentioned that Eckler is out. I believe they said that Melvin Gordon returned to a limited practice today. I have to wait and see. I assume he is going to be back in this week. If he somehow happens to be out, it's gonna be, oh man, it would be tough. Really tough to not play Justin Jackson, plug him in this week as an option. I fully expect this game to be a shootout. I don't like that it's Thursday night games because Thursday night games, this game should be a shootout, but they tend to be more often than not duds on Thursday. I don't like. I don't like so many eggs being in this one basket on Thursday night here. But it'll probably go a long way in determining what the outcome is going to look like, perhaps more so for the isotopes than for Space Antelope going into the weekend here. Just in terms of overall stuff though, I'm going to be honest and I'm going to say that I think Space Antelope wins this matchup. Even though the Isotopes rolled through the regular season, been getting hit with injuries, kind of chipping away at the core of my team. We are Wounded Warriors walking into week 15 here. Even last week, I said Tyreek's nursing an injury. Doug Baldwin said lost AJ Green, lost Greg Olsen, lost some people along the way. It's going to take a big effort from the best players on my team to get through this matchup, and I just don't think that we have the firepower overall to get past Space Antelope this week. I think he's going to go on to another, unfortunately, go on to another Tonto Bowl. Will he win it or will he won't? I have no idea. Because either matchup that he would end up going up against in the Tonto Bowl would be a very competitive team, a very competitive matchup that could get excuse me, could go either way. So that's my prediction right now. Tonto Bowl 16, Mighty Midgets versus Space Antelope. I was correct on round one. We'll see if I'm correct on round two. I'm hoping not. Hoping for another Tonto Bowl for the Isotopes, but like I said, I am not confident in my overall lineup, especially compared to my competition. Said but been chipped away by injuries this so last few weeks. Probably should have traded for a run for a wide, traded one of my plethora of running backs for a wide receiver there to bolster my overall lineup. Now I'm kind of having to go with, said having to pick between an excess of running backs here and hoping that I make the right choices here. So it's going to be a little bit tricky to set that starting lineup. Would have liked to maybe had traded for one more wide receiver there. Probably should have done it or at least tried to. Easy to say that now. Here we are. But yeah, I think Space Antelope is going to win this one because just everything has come together for his team over the past several weeks. No injury problems, everybody's playing pretty well, and just in terms of complete lineup there, I'll admit right now I think he has the better team up and down, but that's we all thought the same thing last year. Nothing is guaranteed until they go out in the field on Sunday here, but yeah, the wide receiver trio has definitely been a weak spot for the Isotopes this week. If some of those guys can come through, so Mike Williams, if he can get a cup, he likes to either do nothing at all or get two touchdowns. So hopefully this is a week where he gets two touchdowns. Other than that, I mean, there's not. I think my lineup is pretty decent, other than those said the wide receiver spots. But it doesn't stack up to Space Antelope there, who really has no holes in his starting lineup. So the team that should win is Space Antelope, but we'll have to wait and see what happens. So, all right, guys, that's it for week 15. Somehow managed to talk about it for half an hour. Good luck to everyone who's coming up in the semi-final round here. We'll see who makes it to Tonto Bowl 16. Good luck to everyone. Hopefully, all of your teams at least meet, if not exceed, expectations. No injuries this week, and hopefully, we have some good competitive matchups. And we'll see you back here again next week as we recap week 15 and see who is moving on to play in Tonto Bowl 16. Will Space Antelope break the I don't say break the curse, but break the streak of it's been what you won. This is year 16. You won in week three, so it's been about 12 or 13 years below the dust. off of Space Antelope here and perhaps break your whatever your curse, your streak, whatever it wants to be. Maybe you can finally notch. Will this be the year that you finally notch that third Tonto Bowl title? Or will Mighty Midgets get number two? Will Gags get number three? Will Springfield Isotopes get number six? I mean, Gags could quite possibly. I think this is his sixth or seventh year. I want to say this is year six for him. So he could quite possibly have three Tonto Bowls in 6 years after this season, which nobody really talks about that. How he's kind of come in and dominated the league ever since he's been in here. So he's been one of the top teams. I think I said last year. No, not last year, but he won when he won it 2 years ago. He was also the number one seed. I think he was up there a couple years as other times as well. Even if he didn't go all the way, he's been pretty steady playoff team here. So he has been definitely worthy competition to all of us. And so we'll see what happens there. So Disco was the only team in the playoffs with trying to get their first Tonto title. And unfortunately, he was unable to do that. So these last two matchups and whoever goes on should be wonderful matchups. Looking forward to seeing what happens this week. And all right, I already said my closing lines here, so and I kept on talking. So, all right, guys, we will see you back here next week and see who is going on to Tonto Bowl 16. All right, thank you, and see you then.